be played on an upper-class instrument. It was written by one upper-class man from New Jersey to an upper-class man from Virginia. And it was done in an English style. Not surprisingly, it's a melody you probably won't remember, or you won't recognize. You won't have heard before. If you have, let me know, please. I'd be surprised. So, let's begin with a little bit of colonial gentility, Americans emulating English culture, importing their fine harpsichords, copying the musical styles, but putting a little bit of an American twist on the subject matter. Follow these words. This is a toast, by the way. Anytime that you take a glass, would you mind? Coffee's fine. These are now bumpers. We just bumped. Not the dance, that's later on. We just bumped glasses, and so the opening line of this song is, "'Tis Washington's health, fill a bumper all around." "'Tis Washington's health, fill a bumper all round, for he is our glory and pride. Our arms shall in battle with conquest be crowned, what virtue and peace on our side. Our arms shall in battle with conquest be crowned, what virtue and peace on our side. 'Tis Washington's health that cannon should roar, the trumpets the truth should proclaim. Cannot be found, search all the world o'er, his equal in virtue and fame. Cannot be found, search all the world o'er, his equal in virtue and fame. 'Tis Washington's our hero to bless, may heaven look graciously down. Oh, long may he live, our hearts to possess, and if freedom still call him her own. Long may he live, our hearts to possess, and if freedom still call him her own. We begin on a little spinet harpsichord. The Washingtons ordered a spinet in the 1750s, I think, early to mid-1750s. Theirs was built by a maker named Plenius. Mine is a reproduction of a spinet built by a different maker named Thomas Hitchcock in 1720. The idea with a spinet, it's analogous to a small upright piano to a grand piano today. If you want to buy a piano, you go to the dentist store, sticker shock on the big grands, right? They're very expensive, they're very big. You need a nice big space in your house, you may not be able to afford that. Well, the Washingtons, the Jeffersons, the other great families of early America, almost all of them started with these smaller, cheaper spinets. As they became more wealthy, they ordered the full-size grands. Now, when you tour the mansion, you'll see the full-size grand harpsichord that's easily three times the size of this. It's a double manual instrument, has two keyboards on it. It's got three sets of strings instead of one. And the strings, instead of running back at an angle against the keyboard like this, they run perpendicularly way down about 8 feet that direction. So it's very much like a grand piano that you'll see in the mansion. These harpsichords, even just the smaller spinets, were so expensive that they were unattainable to about 98% of the society. So an instrument can be a status symbol as well as a form of entertainment. Think for a minute that in 18th century America, really until about the very late 1780s, there were very few professional musicians. We didn't have symphony orchestras per se, we didn't have conservatories, and very few teachers. The teachers would be itinerants who would be called to places like Mount Vernon, because the Washingtons could afford to hire a music master, as it were, to ride his horse and come and to teach the kids, usually, to play. So, as I said, Washington himself couldn't have played that song. He would have enjoyed it very much. I'm sure he did. He could play it. He wouldn't sing along with it. But once he married, once he had adopted children, he knew the importance of music. Immediately, for his adopted son, he bought a violin for Jackie Justice and a German flute. Now, I'm not a violin player, but a violin was very much a man's instrument, as was the German flute. I do have a German flute. German flute simply means the transverse version of the wind instruments we think of today. They were made out of wood in the old days. They would have had ivory fittings. The fittings are what hold the three parts of it together. A modern flute today, of course, is made out of metal. Sometimes silver, sometimes gold. I got to play a gold flute once. That was kind of fun. It's a hard instrument to play. The common flute of the day was this one, which we think of today as a
recorder.
Sure. So, for your kids, if there's a music class in your school and they do recorder, say, nope, don't call it recorder, call it flute, or English flute, or common flute. These are very easy to play. These are much harder to play. You have to fashion your lips across the sound hole to generate a pitch. And there's much more opportunity for mistakes, as I just demonstrated. Okay, so Washington then bought a violin and a German flute for Jackie. For Patsy, he bought the spinet. This is a feminine instrument. Later on, Nellie Custis, I'll show you this, the adopted granddaughter, he bought her an English guitar. I'll talk about and demonstrate that a little bit later. But so amongst the upper classes, we have some instruments that are just unobtainable for others. We have a musical style that, did anyone recognize that song? Don't think so. Did anyone recognize this song that I played though? Here we go, Around the Mulberry Bush, good. Any other sets of words? This is a tune that the Washingtons knew and played here at Mount Vernon. Come on, they're five at least.
Five?
Think about it. You know, but like preschool, this is the way you brush your teeth, right? Comb your hair. Or perhaps at Christmas time, I saw three ships come sailing in, or Lazy Mary, will you get up? There are lots of them. And this represents sort of the other extreme of music surrounding Washington. And that is and Jefferson would have been more of this harpsichord world, right? You know, Jefferson was a musician. He played the violin. And he had a harpsichord. He bought English guitars for his daughters as well. And so Jefferson, like Washington, they knew the importance of music as a sort of an upper-class expression. But the trouble with an upper-class cultural expression is it doesn't necessarily connect to the other people. And it doesn't necessarily express what the other people are thinking. So let me take a couple of tunes that are actually very highly expressive. And I'll begin with this Mulberry Bush tune.